evening, everyone. We're just waiting a few minutes for everyone to log on and join, and then we'll get started. So thank you for joining us. Everyone to join on. I just wanted to brief. My name is Samantha Pearson. I'm Representative Mary Isaacson's Chief of Staff. And I just wanted to kind of remind everybody on the call that if you're having any issues with either unemployment or you need help filling out your property tax rent rebates, any other types of state services, our district office is always open from Monday to Friday from 9 a.m. to 4:30 p.m. If you have any questions at all, you can always email us at repisaacson@pahouse.net. I'm going to drop that email into the chat function in just a moment. And you can also call us at 215-503-3245. We do have our constituent services. Michelle Heinlein is on the call as well with the representative and myself. And I do believe that we also have Teresa Alicia, who is joining on Facebook Live. So we're all here and we're always able to help you kind of navigate, even if it's not within the state services. We're happy to kind of connect you with the right resource and either organization or office that can assist you. And also, I do just always want to plug us. If you're not already following us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter, please do so at Rep. Mary Isaacson. It is one of the best ways to get updates about what's going on in the Pennsylvania House on a regular hourly basis, which I'm certain, as you've seen from news articles, there's quite a bit happening lately. And also, we do have a weekly email that we send out only on Fridays. It's a good roundup of the week of what's happening in Harrisburg that's affecting you in Philadelphia. And if you haven't signed up for that already, I really recommend that you do it. You can do so right on the representative's website, which I'll also drop the link into the chat then. And without further ado, I'm going to hand it over to the Representative Isaacson, as I'm certain that's who you really want to hear from tonight. Thank you.
Thank you, Samantha. And thank you all for joining us tonight. You know, it's been a long time since we've all been able to get together because of this pandemic, but it's really great to try and connect and give you some updates on what's going on in Harrisburg that's gonna be affecting your life. So thank you for joining us. And I want to talk about, you know, where we're at here in Harrisburg. We just started a new legislative session. I have been appointed the vice chair of the policy committee. I have been appointed to the environmental, energy, and resources committee. I'm on the education committee and the liquor committee. So those are going to be my focuses as we go through this next legislative session. And I very much look forward to getting to work. We've started, as I am in Harrisburg, and we have been in session this week. And, you know, the nice thing is that while we've had some controversial stuff going on, which I'm sure a lot of people have read about, we actually are doing some really good work on behalf of the people in a bipartisan fashion. In fact, today we started moving legislation that's going to allow the Pennsylvania National Guard to organize in the next 45 days to help distribute the vaccine as it becomes more and more available. That's going to be a statewide effort, but certainly they're going to be able to try and help in Philadelphia also. So as more vaccines become available, we're going to have more people who are trained and able to help distribute it. So that's something good that's started today, and hopefully it'll get final passage tomorrow, and the Senate hopefully will pass it quickly. Also, today we amended in appropriations the distribution of the federal GERDS money. That's the latest stimulus money that got approved in December. And we're getting that out to schools, hospitals. There's going to be a lot of money for rental assistance and housing. And so we're trying to start addressing the needs and for the hospitality industry. A large portion of the money is going to be created in a fund to be applied for the small businesses, not necessarily the big chains, the small businesses that have been affected, so that we can make sure that we can see them on the other side of this, as we're hopefully getting very close to the other side of this. But this week in Harrisburg, we had the governor delivering his budget address a bit after the snowstorm, but it's an exciting, bold, and progressive budget proposal. You know, I'm very proud that the governor has tried to put forth a budget that really will make investments in Pennsylvania. The investments include anything from making more equitable criminal justice system to making education at the forefront. And I'm prepared tonight to go through some of these details with you, and then we'll take questions afterwards. So one of the big things you probably all heard in the news this week was about the governor's proposal to try and make the tax system here in Pennsylvania more equitable. And I'm going to start with it, and then we can loop around at the end on why it's really necessary. But some of the things that he's proposing is to really do a tax forgiveness for those who are not making a lot of money. We have to try and deal with the uniformity clause. And so if everybody is taxed at the same uniform level, when you give them tax forgiveness, depending on their income status and the amount of dependents in that household, it makes it so that there's a more equitable system. For example, basically under this tax forgiveness program, a family of four making no more than $50,000 is not going to be paying income tax. We really need to get to a point where we are not having a situation where we're keeping people in perpetual poverty because of our tax system. And I'm glad that the governor is going about this, trying to address this in this way. We're also going to try and do some corporate tax reforms, lowering some of the corporate taxes, but also by closing what we call the Delaware loophole, which basically just means a corporation has to do a combined reporting, not just in the state they're incorporated in, but also the one in which they operate in and pay taxes on it. Right now, if a large corporation is incorporated in Delaware, they don't pay their tax to Pennsylvania where they operate in. They pay to Delaware. So we need to close that and start understanding that we need to recover those revenues so that everybody's paying their fair share and all the funds that are needed to operate Pennsylvania government becomes available to us. So that's another bold initiative that dealing with taxes that the governor is putting forth. But I think I'm most excited about is that he's really trying to address in this budget making education equitable for everyone. You know, we've had years of studies, and we had a fair funding formula put together back in 2015, but because of the makeup of the legislature, we really haven't had the funds distributed according to the fair funding formula. And just so you know that, you know, the fair funding formula was created by a board that was bipartisan, and they took into account, you know, things like poverty, concentrated poverty, English language learners, district disparities, charter schools.
Really haven't had
a district's ability to raise revenue, and whether they could actually do it, and what median household incomes were. And that formula, should we actually get the education budget to go through it, should make it much more equitable for everyone. You know, right now, nationally, Pennsylvania basically is reported as being one of the most inequitable school funding states in the nation, and that needs to change. It's kind of a good way of looking at it is, think if you have a pizza pie, and you're supposed to be cutting it up equitably, as opposed to saying, well, you get this little sliver and this person's getting this big, huge piece. So the governor is proposing that we take our massive education budget, which is over $6 billion. And right now, only about 11% of that goes through the fair funding formula. And he wants to make the entire thing go through the fair funding formula, which would certainly make it more equitable across the 501 school districts in the Commonwealth. Some of the highlights in his proposal is, as I said, it's $6.25 billion is what we have as our education budget right now, and that's $6.25 billion needs to go through this formula to try and make it so that we hold people harmless, because we are required in Pennsylvania to hold harmless, and meaning that you must make sure that the funding that was for the previous year is sustained so that no school district loses a massive amount of money. He's wanting to infuse another $1.15 billion to make sure that all school districts are protected as we make this shift. And that's including like $200 million more for each school district alone before even we put through the fair funding formula. So basically a recap is we're going to do a $1.35 billion increase in basic education, $200 million for special education, $25 million increase in pre-K, $5 million increase for Head Start, $11 million in age 3 through 5 early intervention, so we can capture all children. And one of the things I'm very excited about is he's proposing to make charter school reforms to the tune of $229 million in reforms if we can get these through. And these reforms come in the way of basically $130 million in savings just by making a flat funding for student tuition to a cyber charter school. Cyber charter school doesn't have a brick and mortar building, nor do they have the upkeep, but currently they get the same funding formula as a for every per pupil that a regular school has with all the upkeep costs, but they have none. So we have a flat funding that's going to save about $130 million right there. And then a $99 million savings with regard to special education funding formulas. And I think that if we're able to make some of those charter school reforms, along with the investment and infusion of money into education, that we truly will be able to start moving the education system in Pennsylvania from the below all other state levels to being one in the forefront of making sure we're investing in our children. And that's from pre-K right through upper education. And I'm really happy that he's willing to try and make those investments. And that's a fight that I plan on working very hard to make sure that we can get as much of that done in the negotiation process. Some of the other interesting things he's thrown into this budget, because he certainly did throw everything at the wall in it, is he wants to legalize the adult use of cannabis. He's proposing law enforcement reforms. other criminal justice reforms, such as bail and pretrial reforms, probation reforms, clean slate legislation, compensatory for wrongly convicted individuals. And he's planning on proposing a fee for the Pennsylvania State Police. I don't think people in Philadelphia realize, since we have our own police department, that a good portion of the rest of Pennsylvania, who does not have their own police department, uses the state police as their local police. And that's funded by the general fund and not by the local municipalities. And they need to start paying into that fund for the police protections and resources that they take from the rest of the Commonwealth. So going a little deeper into some of the things he's planning on this with the legalized adult use cannabis, he wants to use that revenue to support disadvantaged small business through grant funding. He wants to support restorative justice programs to help individuals and communities that have been adversely affected by the criminalization of marijuana, which we all know is a systemic problem of our past that we need to address now, as we've seen the ramifications of that in our communities. Again, he wants to do probation reform. Some of those is changing the time of supervision to limit the risks to the community, changing the total length of the supervision, and creating opportunities to reduce the time under supervision with incentives. The clean slate legislation would allow for more serious offenses to be considered, and reducing wait periods for lesser offenses. And some of the medical release reforms are, again, compensation for wrongly convicted individuals. So as you can see, our governor has taken a bold step towards the criminal justice reforms that are duly needed, since we haven't had any in decades. Also included in his budget is making the workforce more equitable. And I applaud him for wanting to get to a point where we are raising the minimum wage to $15 an hour. Certainly in Philadelphia, you can't raise a family or take care of them on the $7.25 that it is now. He's proposing a $12 per hour minimum wage to be increased 50 cent increments until 2027. And you got to remember, as we raise the minimum wage, that just generates more money that gets spent out into the economy. To the tune of, he's estimating with the personal income tax and everything else, about $116 million more money into the economy. Another thing is, he wants to make sure we take care of teachers. In Pennsylvania, there is no minimum salary standard. So his proposal is to create a basic salary platform of $45,000 for a teacher. And it's a tragedy that we have areas in Pennsylvania where a teacher isn't even making $45,000 as a basic salary when we entrust our children's education to them. So that's something I'm looking forward to helping fight for as we go through this budget process. And he also wants to increase the basic rate for childcare workers so that we could have qualified people in the workforce, and making sure that we are investing in making sure childcare is more affordable and accessible so that people can be out in the workforce. One of the things we've seen in this pandemic is a huge resource problem for our essential workers in having access to adequate childcare. We call them essential workers, yet we don't make it possible for them to go out and work when they have to take care of their children, who we have put in home for everybody's safety. So I'm very excited that he's planning on doing that. And one of my favorites that he's put in his budget is, he's going back trying to get a severance tax on the Marcellus shale industry. The shale industry, while I'm not for the expansion or in perpetuity of fossil fuels, As long as they're here, I think we should be able to be generating a tax off of a resource that belongs in Pennsylvania. And as they are affecting our economy and our environment, they should be paying their fair share towards this Commonwealth. And the governor is proposing that we tax them and go back to what we originally called our plan for PA, and we're calling it Back to Work for PA. And it's about a $3 billion investment in funding for the Commonwealth through the seventh tax. And some of the things he wants to spend that money on is training, career link, apprenticeships, again, child care subsidies, funding for developing an on-site child care facilities at workplaces, so we don't even have to worry about parents not being able to be near their children. He wants to shore up critical supply lines and expand broadband across the Commonwealth. We've certainly seen in this pandemic the chasm that we have in access to the internet, and where everybody is telling you to, well, sign up on the internet, go to this website, if you don't have access or the proper technology, as many of our impoverished areas have, you can't do that. So as we're telling, and we're seeing this with the COVID vaccine rollout, everyone's being directed to websites, and then everybody's talking about the inequities of the distribution and how this is going to be handled. Well, if you don't have access to the website, you can't sign up for it. So we need to make sure that we support the governor and push for the severance tax so that we can expand access to the internet and information for all of Pennsylvanians, whether you're urban or rural. Another aspect of this vast budget he's put forward is making, you know, human services more equitable. He wants to invest $1 million to expand legal services, $1 million to increase and develop comprehensive direct care to workers training, $1 million increase to reduce the number of child and youth in out of home placement. And when you think about how many children live in poverty, especially in the city of Philadelphia, making sure that there's funds so that we can stop them from ending up homeless is something that we should all get behind as a society, because every child is going to be our future generation. He also wants to make sure that we can have additional funding up to $1 million to discharge individuals from state hospital facilities. There are many individuals that are, because of their insurance, are required to be in state hospitals when then they don't necessarily need to be, especially when they can have home health care. And community-based services. So he's planning on doing waivers for community-based services and continue to serve high school graduates and their families as they're trying to find their place in society. So I think the most important thing, again, for Philadelphia with regard to the human service aspect is to really make an investment in trying to take care of the number of children and youth who are in a situation where they might have out-of-home placement, housing instability, and we want to certainly promote family stability and reunification. And finally, you know, wrapping this up, part of his proposal is also to open up grant programs so that we can get bonds taken out to invest in lead and asbestos abatement, which, you know, in Philadelphia, certainly we know the importance of this with regard to our schools and the facility deficits that we have, and to be able to access funds that have been inaccessible to the school district so that they can rehabilitate these buildings so that they're safe environments for our children, our teachers, and the other workers in the school district, so they have a safe working and learning environment. So in all honesty, this is a really bold budget, and I'm very excited about it. Obviously, my colleagues on the other side are not so much, but that's what we have, a divided government, and we're going to have to try and work to find what we can all live with and how we can invest in Pennsylvania. But to do this, what the governor is really proposing, that I don't want to get lost, is that he's looking to find reoccurring revenue. We haven't found reoccurring revenue in a very long time in Pennsylvania, well over a decade. And we just can't sit around and say, well, we're going to wait for the feds to give us money, or we have to live within what revenue comes in. Sooner or later, you have to make investments to get returns. And we learned during the Rendell years, when we got a large federal stimulus payment, that once that stimulus money went away, we had large deficits that we still today are trying to recover from. And we can't do that again with the money that comes from this pandemic. The money that comes from the feds for this pandemic has to help the state rebuild, but it certainly isn't the reoccurring revenue and investment that we need to be making in the Commonwealth. So the governor is going for the severance tax, corporate business tax reforms. But the one thing that you've heard about, and I said I'd circle back to, is his proposal with regard to income tax, the personal income tax in Pennsylvania. You know, everything's a negotiation. So right now in Pennsylvania, we have one of the lowest income taxes in the country, especially with regard to our surrounding states. Even West Virginia, Ohio, New York, New Jersey, all the states that surround us have significantly higher personal income taxes. So it's been a long time coming that we really need to make an adjustment in this. He's proposing to move it to a 4.49% from a 3.07. While it seems like a large hike, considering we haven't done it in decades, it's about time we do make an adjustment. I don't know, where it's going to end up, but you always shoot high. So we're shooting high to try and create a funding revenue stream that's going to be able to make the investments in the Commonwealth that really need to be made in all sectors that I've spoke about tonight. So with that, I think that if, I don't know if there's any, I guess I need to open up the chat to see if there's any questions. does anybody have any questions, or do you want me just keep going on this? Samantha, you're muted.
If you have a question, you can either put it in the chat or raise your hand. And for those watching on Facebook, you can leave it in the comments, and Michelle from our team will send it over to us.
And by the way, just to go back to the tax plan, to give you an example so people really understand, that with the tax formula that he is proposing, with the tax forgiveness program, that basically there will be a tax cut for about 40% of the population in Pennsylvania. There will be no tax change for about 27% of the people of Pennsylvania. So we're looking at a tax change only of about 33% of Pennsylvanians. And I think that when you look at it and the numbers that they're projecting, if we stick with his bold initiative, that it will be something that I think that those who can afford that 33% are going to understand that it's not going to break the bank, but it's going to help make the investment in Pennsylvania. So,
Representative, we did have a question from Mike Harris as to why is only 11% of education money in fair funding?
That's a great question. Okay, so back during the Rendell years, they did a costing out study on what, you know, the investments that Pennsylvania makes in education. And we were woefully inadequate compared to other states for state level funding towards our school districts. Pennsylvania relies in most of the counties on a very high property tax to fund the schools. And so we've made incremental changes in that. And then in, 2009, we had the economic downfall and we had the stimulus money come in and we dumped that into the education budget. But when that dried up, as I said earlier, we never backfilled it or found any recurring revenue to support it. So what ended up happening was the budget cuts of $1 billion out of education during the Corbett years, which people might remember. In case you don't, we basically cut education funding by over $1 billion statewide, and many school districts suffered from it. Those in more stable communities were able to backfill the lost revenue with property tax, but certainly Philadelphia suffered drastically from it. In 2015, as I said, we passed the fair funding formula, but unfortunately, where we should have been sending all of the $6 billion+ through the fair funding formula for these past 5 years, the decision was made in the budgeting process to only put the new money that was invested each year through the fair funding formula, which is why we're only at an 11% of that $6 billion. So you have, again, I go back to the pizza pie analogy, you had the majority of that money being divided up with only the new money that was added each budget year going through the fair funding formula. What the governor is proposing now is to get rid of the pizza pie cutting up method and send all the money through the fair funding formula so that it gets distributed equitably to all 501 school districts. So it's a massive investment in education that, you know, I'm fully supportive of. And certainly Philadelphia, with our poverty levels and all the other things you need to take into account that are part of that fair funding formula, we would get a significant amount more in state funding towards our education system. And that's very significant considering that we are the largest school district of the 501 school districts in the Commonwealth, and we have the most charter schools that are draining the funds of our school district.
Representative, we do have two questions. One is coming from our Facebook stream and the other one is coming from our website stream. So I'm going to start with the one from the website. If cannabis legalization is successful, will that reduce the need for income tax increases since it will be a significant tax source?
Well, no, is the short answer, because under the governor's proposal, the funding source from the legalization of cannabis would be directed in certain areas, like I said, broadband, dealing with different community aspects. It wouldn't be directed towards, you know, the general operating budget of the Commonwealth as a whole. So he's proposing right now legalizing it and then using those generated funding streams into dedicated areas where we need to make investments in the Commonwealth. Again, we are this is just his proposed budget. It's not getting, nothing's getting passed until our budget deadline is June 30th. So things can be changing and negotiated, but the revenue funding stream that would be generated by cannabis is not near the amount of money that would be generated from the adjusted personal income tax that he's proposing. So it's really a matter of where we end up in the negotiation. But again, I commend him for understanding that we have not made investments in coming up with dedicated revenue streams to make investments in Pennsylvania. Is he shooting for the stars? Absolutely. I don't know where it's going to end up at the end, but we certainly want to I wanted to get the information out to everybody on what he's proposing, because you're going to read a lot of stuff and you're going to have skewed views on all of it. But he, you know, these are different revenue streams that he thinks can be used to invest in the Commonwealth.
That's kind of what you said there, Representative. One of our Facebook questions, as you said, the governor is shooting for the stars. It's one of his more bold budgets. Which particular areas of expanded spending do you believe there is significant interest in among your Republican colleagues?
Certainly education. It's the one place where we have you know, bipartisan support. I do sit on the education committee, and I will say that we do work with our colleagues with regard to funding all aspects of education that come through the committee. And you have to remember, education is not just basic K through 12. You know, we're trying to make investments in early childhood education, because the sooner you can start capturing a young mind and directing it and educating and getting the information that might not be available in homes, is the more prepared they are to get into that K through 12 education system. And, you know, then we get on to higher ed and career and technical training and, you know, accessibility for just, say, a certificate program all the way up to, you know, four-year degrees, whether it's through our state system of higher education or the community colleges that are so vital to so many areas around the Commonwealth, and is the accessible, affordable education to so many around the Commonwealth. It truly is an area that we have bipartisan discussions and come to what might not be everybody's wish list, but we seem to be able to come to, in a lot of aspects, a place where we can live with. And certainly if we had a more dedicated funding pool to work from, we can make more and more investments. So it's really getting to creating that funding pool and that steady stream of funds so that we can make those investments in the Commonwealth.
We have an additional question off of Facebook. You mentioned the majority of Pennsylvanians will not see a significant tax increase or change. Who are they, and who are the people who will see an increase? Is there a breakdown in that type of, you know, you said 27% and not?
Well, I have a lot of charts in front of me, but basically, if say a family of four is making $50,000 or less, right now they're paying a personal income tax. Under their tax forgiveness, that after they file their income tax and they see what it is in their dependent level, then they will have a tax forgiveness where they won't see a personal income tax. For many, their personal income taxes won't change because they'll be in that income bracket. But certainly when you get up to higher income levels, you're going to see a tax increase that for that 1 to 1.5% that's being proposed, which is not set in stone. It could be significantly less, and it could be around that area. We don't know that as of right now, but certainly, you know, if you're married, dependents, and you're making $110,000, you would be paying the full increase. Whereas a family with the same amount of dependents that only makes $50,000, they would not. That's where where it's a tax forgiveness once you've filed and they see what the income range is.
And another question from Facebook. Is there increased funding for higher education as well? I know we talked about our public schools, but what is put forth for our colleges and our technical schools?
Absolutely. As of right now, the higher education systems are all getting the revenue that they've been getting consistently at the same levels. There are no cuts in higher education in the general operating budget that's proposed. But I will say that today I was happy to see of the money that is going to be distributed from the federal government that we're increasing I think it's $14 million to the community colleges and about five to the PASHE system, which is the state system of higher education right now. Some of the private schools, they'll be also be getting money under the private school funding that came through the federal government. And certainly, hopefully, we are going to have a bigger investment as we hear President Biden pushing for another round of money to come to us. And certainly, we know that we're going to try and make sure all the institutions continue. But there are no cuts to any of the higher education systems, whether it's the state-related, which is Penn, Pitt, Temple, Penn State, Lincoln, and then you have, again, the PASHE system, and then the private colleges can apply through the federal government themselves.
There are no additional questions right now at this time. Please feel free to keep on sending over questions for those who are watching. Representative, did you want to kind of talk about how you see negotiations moving and what you really are advocating for?
Well, the governor just made his budget address this week. So we're about to go into weeks of what the appropriations hearings, where they the governor's offices and his secretaries come forth and vet their proposed plans to the General Assembly and justifying their budgets and their investments and how they plan on spending it. And it helps shape the budget bill that usually comes out around the late April timeframe. And that bill will be the opening salvo from both the Senate and the House in how they want to spend revenues and what they're willing to do. And then we're going into the negotiations. The question is, what's the gauntlet the governor's going to lay down, and where is he going to negotiate and either reduce or give up on or push for? And we did have a budget standoff his first year, and I think that he understands that this being the closing years of his administration, he wants to make sure that we're trying to make the investment we can. You know, this pandemic certainly has shown all of us in society where we have holes and gaps and where people were able to sustain. There are plenty of people who haven't had their life financially affected whatsoever and have been able to safely stay at home. And there's plenty of people who have, certainly my office knows, suffered greatly in this pandemic as jobs have been lost, funding reduced, rents, coming due and the funds aren't there to make them. We've done the best we could to support society during a pandemic. No one ever gave us a rule book or a playbook on how to govern society during this. And I think that watching this for the last 11 months, we've all come to learn that there are definitely areas that we need to make investments in society. And I applaud the governor for wanting to start the opening negotiating conversation, shooting for the stars. Again, I'm very happy that he's putting forth the severance tax proposal. We need to find recurring revenue, and we have not touched the PIT in decades. I don't know if it's going to end up being anywhere where he's proposing it. We don't know where it's going to end up, but I definitely applaud him for trying to start that conversation and making sure that when he leaves office in 2022, that he's leaving Pennsylvania in a better place than he found it. And I look forward to working with him to try and get that negotiation through as we go through this budget season. So, I wanted this town hall plan so that as we got this budget started and started having these discussions, because people really understand how important government is. You know, we spent decades of everyone talking about how government's supposed to run like a business, and it's not. Government is supposed to be there providing services for you. And we need to make sure that we're dealing with all aspects of that. And, you know, again, I applaud the governor for that. You know, during this legislative session, we have other important issues that are going to be coming up. Transportation funding is going to be a huge issue that we need to deal with this legislative session. And that includes for us in Philadelphia, SEPTA funding. So we have to make sure that we have the adequate funds, again, reoccurring revenue to support these things. You know, the Funding Transportation Trust Fund is going belly up as their revenue is going to cease next year. And so we need to make sure that we have revenue for that. So that's whether it's education, transportation, or all the investments that we need to make in the Commonwealth, we need to find the reoccurring revenue for it. And so I applaud, again, that we're looking at all different sources, whether it's legalizing cannabis, the shale tax, PIT. If my colleagues on the other side of the aisle want to come up with an alternative proposal for a recurring revenue that sustains the government and makes sure it's there supporting you, then I'm more than happy to be open to it. But I haven't heard any ideas from them, except if we can't afford it, we need to cut it. And we certainly can't have anything else cut from Philadelphia, the education system, transportation, and all the other government services that need to be providing for our society. So that's basically where we're at this point in a new legislative session that just started.
Representative, we do have additional questions that are coming in, as long as we have time. So one from Facebook is, and then I'll get to my Karis's in the chat. As a retiree, are there any monies going towards CSRS or PSRS in this proposed budget?
We are making all our funding obligations in this budget, which, you know, is something that I would fight for. We have made a promise. You come work for the state and you're a good employee and you contribute to your pension, that it's supposed to be there for you at the end. And I don't think that the Commonwealth should be a deadbeat employer and not meet their obligation. Pensions are, I and every other state worker pays into the pension fund, just as everybody in the private sector pays into either a pension fund or a 401k. And our obligation is to make sure that we're funding that at the sustainable route. In this budget, we are funding the pension system under our obligations.
Mike Harris in the chat, he seems to think that you might have already kind of answered his question that he had. But he said, is there a competing budget priority proposal or plan that is out there from the governor's opposition? Or will the legislature be reacting to the governor's proposal?
No, they have not put out an alternative proposal as of yet. All I heard yesterday was, and it was on video, I don't have to, all I heard yesterday was that the governor is, dead on arrival on this and that he should resign for even thinking to propose such a budget. But that's, welcome to the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. It's a lot of divergent views, and we have to understand that not only do we have to get 102 votes in the House, you have to get 26 votes in the Senate, and you have to get the governor's signature. So it truly is going to be a negotiation. And with this kind of bold budget that he's put forth, I think that getting that governor's signature on something that doesn't include investments in Pennsylvania is going to be rather difficult. And one thing that my colleagues on my side of the aisle and in the Senate have done is we've stood by the governor for this past year as I've watched people on the other side of the aisle unhappy with his decisions in getting us through this pandemic and trying to keep us safe, trying continually take away and erode his authority. And again, he doesn't have a playbook on how to govern during a pandemic. All he's tried to do is keep us safe. And we've shown that we're willing to stick with him in this vision as he got reelected for a second term by the entire Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. So where there might be divergent views in each one of my colleagues' district for the 64,000 people they represent, the governor has the 12 million people in Pennsylvania that voted for him.
Representative, we have an additional question. I know the representative spent a lot of time checking out parks and recreation areas in and around her district during the pandemic. Is there any proposed funding or increased funding for our parks and recreation statewide or specifically within Philadelphia?
Well, there is a slight increase in the DCNR budget, which is where the entity that runs the state parks. And we certainly have seen how important the state park system has been when we've all looked for some sort of place to find some solace when we have to be socially distanced and isolate. And I certainly will advocate for as much increased funding. And if we can get a severance tax, I will definitely advocate for making sure that it's a dedicated funding stream to taking care of this environment in Pennsylvania, because they're shared resources and they are the crown jewels of the Commonwealth, and we need to make sure that they're taken care of and sustained for future generations.
And just so you see, and for those here, Michelle from our team is just sharing some of the graphics that are overviews of what the representative has been speaking about. And you can also obviously find them on our social media channels and in that weekly newsletter I referenced earlier. Are there any additional questions? Seeing none, I don't know if you want to give closing thoughts, Representative.
Absolutely, and thank you. I appreciate all the questions, and I appreciate for all of you who are watching on either Facebook or my website, and those of you who chose to join us here in this meeting, in this town hall. It's been great to be able to talk to you and connect with you. All of you who know me know how much I enjoyed pre-pandemic getting out and either knocking on doors or having meetings so that you can be in touch with me and I can hear what's going on in all of our communities so that I can go out and represent you well out in Harrisburg and also make sure that everybody's needs are met within our community. And I'm glad that I'm able to come and, as we've all learned how to live off of a screen and technology, we're able to connect and reach out. And I look forward to continuing this conversation as we go through the budget process. And I would love feedback through my website or email us on, you know, if you enjoyed this, what you would want to see town halls on, what topics later on, because I can certainly do have more town halls and have them with different people from different agencies in the Commonwealth joining us for if there's an issue-oriented town hall that's requested. So thank you so much for joining us tonight, and I hope everybody stays safe and wear a mask.